Good morning, or afternoon, or evening, whatever time you are worshiping with us, and however you are worshiping with us, if it's on your phone, on a tablet, a computer, or a television set. We are honored that we can worship together and welcome you to Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. When we begin worship, we like to just be present and to be here and be here now. And one of the ways that we can enter into prayer is through our breathing. Our minds are busy and they're full and they're racing, and to stop and to be here in worship. So I'm standing right now, and if you're sitting, just plant your feet firmly on the ground and sit yourself up a little straighter and take some deep breaths, you know, deep into your abdomen. Close your eyes. And it's in this presence that we are here with the Holy Spirit that's at work in our life and in our world. Amen. We do this with our children at Good Shepherd. We talk about prayer and how to begin prayer. And when you talk to the really little kids in preschool, if you ask them to breathe like I just did with you, they look back at you because they're already breathing and they don't know what you mean. So you have to talk to little kids like this. Smell the flower and blow out the candle. Smell the flower and blow out the candle. So with our little kids, so if you have little ones in your life, that's how you can talk to little kids about how to breathe, how to calm down, and how to be present. So whether we're breathing or smelling the flowers and blowing out the candles. God be with you.
And also with you.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen. As we come to worship, it is important that we bring a prayer of confession. A confession is where we are lifting up the burdens of our heart, the things we've said and not said, the things we've done and not done, the things we have thought and not thought. It's in those prayers of confession where we lift off, it becomes a prayer of wholeness. That's where God works for ways of wholeness and reconciliation and for peace. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon the people, whose goodness cascades over all of creation. Amen. Amen. Let's confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. And we can be assured of God's grace and God's abundant love. How vast is God's grace through the power and promise of Jesus Christ. Our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the spirits of reconciling peace. Amen. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
The day. Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service. Strengthen us by your Spirit and make us worthy of your call. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Jonah, chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and 10. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on a sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is a reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 through 31. Brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none. And those who mourn, as though they were not mourning. And those who rejoice, as though they were not rejoicing. And those who buy, as though they had no possessions. And those who deal with the world, as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading today comes from the book of Mark. It's chapters 1 through verses 14 through 20. And this is a call story. Listen to God's word. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent. Believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, his brother Andrew, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets, followed him. As he went a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God endures forever. Amen.
It's good to see all of you.
I
like seeing your faces, and you're all sitting so well, and your rug is cleaned up, and it's really nice to see you do this. And you're listening to your teacher. This is a really, and you know what's important? You are listening to your teacher. Mr. Travis said, "This is what we're going to do. Pastor Dan is coming." And you listened, you put everything away, and you sat down. And listening is part of, I brought my chapter book again.
Chapter?
See my little chapter book? And you know what I like about my chapter book? It has pictures in it. See these pictures? See those? See those pictures?
Mm-hmm.
Well, those are people, and they're in front of a church like this, like a church. And they're praying, but they're kind of showing off. They're kind of bragging, showing off. And then you have these pictures here. You see them?
Yeah.
Here's a nice picture. And then Jesus says, you know, you don't have to pray and show off. There's other ways you can pray. And let me teach you how to pray. So they gather around, and he's got another. He's teaching them how to pray. And he's praying, and be like children. That's what he's saying. Be like children, just like all of you. Which there's just, be honest. And so he's talking about his prayers, and then they all gather around. See this? See the picture? So they're all gathered around, and he has this. I think we're in a new chapter here. So we have more. See all these nice little faces?
Yeah.
And they're all these little kids just like you. And the reason Jesus says this is, remember last week I brought my toolbox, and you're going to start doing this when you get to kindergarten.
I'm going to kindergarten.
Wait. I know you're going to go next year.
But last week,
there's a tool, and we call it the breathing tool. But when we're in here, we call it smell the flowers.
Blow out the candle.
Exactly. Smell the flower.
Blow out the candle.
Blow out the candle. Smell the flower,
blow out the candle.
Smell the flower, blow out the candle. Smell the flower, blow out the candle. And Jesus is saying that if you do that when you start to pray, smell the flower, blow out the candle, and remember our listening tool? And it says, and listen. Smell the flower, blow out the candle, and listen. When we do these things, that's the form of prayer. And that's how we want to pray. Smell the flower, blow out the candle, and listen. And when we do those, that's how we can start to pray to God. Question, yes?
I got a new water bottle.
You got a new water bottle. Is it a question or a statement? Question? What's your question?
Did you know I got a skateboard?
I did not know that.
I have a question. What is this?
Uh-huh. And so this is how we can pray. So when next year when we get to chapel, we're going to do some of these things. Where we're going to smell the flower. When you get to kindergarten, we're going to blow out the candle. And we're going to work on some of these things, just like Jesus said with all of his friends.
No, wait, Pastor Dan?
Yes.
I'm working all day long with my ingenuity and my perseverance rover, and the rocks would have gold and the flight thing.
Pastor Dan?
Yes.
I got a new textbook back from Christmas.
Good for you.
And lots
of new things. You got lots of new nice things. Yeah.
I have skateboard too.
You got a skateboard? Sounds like you've got a lot of nice things.
I don't need to learn anymore.
Can we do an echo prayer? Let's do an echo prayer, okay? We're going to put our hands together. We're going to smell the flower. Blow out the candle. Dear God. Thank you for today.
Thank you for today.
Thank you for our teacher.
Thank you for our teacher.
Our church.
Our church.
Our school.
And our family.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, boys and girls. I sure love seeing you every week.
Friends, please pray with me. Living God, may the meditation of all of our hearts, the word read, proclaimed, our prayers prayed, our songs sung, restore us, renew us. Make us new in you to be the lights of Christ you call us to be in our life, in our world. In Jesus' name, amen. We have these wonderful readings about being called by God. And we have one from the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, of Jonah. And then we have the Gospel of Mark and Jesus calling the disciples. And these are wonderful scriptures to read, especially now. Particularly the Jonah passage it's a lot of fun. So you can read it if you want to read it literally, about God calling Jonah. Or is it a tall tale about a man swallowed by a fish who gets spit up on the shore? And if you look at it through that lens, you'll also get to the point about calling, but you'll experience all of the fun pleasure that Jonah has to offer. And there's a lot of humor in Jonah. To hear this story of this man who is resistant to God, being sent, called to Nineveh, the last place he wants to go. And Nineveh is just this vile place, and it is it's a size that is just kind of preposterous, where it takes all these days to even walk through it. So it's this town of it's just immeasurable. And Jonah is to go there and proclaim the word of God. And then he shouts it out, and all of a sudden everyone in the whole town then converts. And then, as we're more familiar with the passage in Jonah, where he's swallowed up by this fish, and then he's spit up on the shore. And now Jonah thinks the people in Nineveh, you know, are pretty unclean people, and now he's been spit up on a fish, so I imagine him to be a pretty unclean person at that moment. So we have a lot of kind of humor that's at play here. There's a lot of resisting God, running from God. And with that, then we hear this deeply profound Gospel of Mark. And there's an immediacy where Jesus is walking on the shores of Galilee and calling. And he calls these disciples. I've heard sermons over the years from seminary students and others will look at it this way and say, hey, look at they put down their net. You know, they followed Jesus and we should be more like them. And that's okay. But sometimes our lives aren't always lived that way. To put everything down and go walk and follow someone. I don't know if many of us would do that. And I think this story calls us to something a little deeper than that. And it might be something like this. When he calls the disciples, they get up, they leave their nets, and they go and follow him. It doesn't say they walked away from fishing forever. You know, they may have come back to it, and they may have had that, so we don't really know. But I think in this calling, we can look at this as far as putting things down. And there might be things in our own life that are worth putting down. The nets that we have to hold on to, maybe they're things that we can take a deep inward look at ourselves. Say, what are these things that we can put down, release ourselves from, that might be holding us back, so that we can follow God, we can do the work of God in some grand way, or maybe even the smallest of ways. And that's powerful. That's life-changing. So often we think that we look at any kind of growth in God, or spiritual growth or religious growth, however we want to frame it, that it's going to be something big and grand. It's going to be sweeping, as if, you know, Moses is going to appear, there's going to be a burning bush, or the seas are going to part. And it's not always like that. It can be the very smallest of things. That one small step, that one slight change that we make in our life. Either something we do, we don't do, we take on, or we shed ourselves from. And I see this calling of the disciples as this, and this can be timely for us as we look at the things that we want to set down so that we can live deeper into God's calling. And when we look at the Jonah, there is a lot of resistance from Jonah. His resistance is played out in wildly comical ways, which make the story deeply pleasurable and enjoyable. And with that resistance, we can be assured of our own resistance at times when we are being called by God. We often talk about prayer, meditation in our sermons, and sometimes we're distracted. And those are normal aspects of prayer life, are the distractions. We can have a lot of noise in our head, in our life. And it's very difficult to get off of those. I was doing some meditation, you know, today, but also during this week, and my mind's moving around, and I just let that be. It's just a way of being. But in time, I'll start to just focus on my breath and the being here now. And this is a place, I think, of real transformation. And I wonder if those disciples, when they met Jesus on the shores of Galilee, when Jesus calls them to be a fisher of people, and they set that down as if something profound had shifted and changed, that I'm being called by the work of God. And that's something worth doing. And we've read passages over the last few weeks about Hineni, and God coming in, and all these wonderful passages that we've read. And here's a continuation of that. So these are themes in our life, and that's why we read them right now at the beginning of the year. We have just come out of the Christmas season and baptism of the Lord, and now these next readings that are before us are these call stories about God coming in radical ways, calling and nudging us. And we're on an edge of a new year. And this is something that we can do. And especially with us sheltered in place now and all the things that we know to be true. Even with those happening, how can we find ways of creating ritual and connection with each other? How do we find those very small ways of doing the work of God? Sometimes that will just be, and this is huge, just praying for other people. We had an election, and we had an inauguration this week. And sometimes whatever we feel about the results of that inauguration, wherever we are in that, but we can think about, this is a time to pray. Pray for other people. People who might be different than us or think differently than us. This can be something that can be transformative for each of us as we kind of shed some of those nets that we have in our life that we are kind of burdened by, that we can go into this new year. So my friends, for our church, certainly for our world, for your life, this is a place here and now. And I'm doing this too, a sense of calling. How am I listening to God, trusting God? How am I, what are the things that I'm shedding and letting go of? I was talking with a minister friend, and she's going through a great transformation, moving and going through all of these things. And so she has a lot of anxiety. And another friend of hers said, well, ultimately that anxiety is going to turn into excitement. So just know that your anxiety now is tomorrow's excitement. And that little step and that little shift can be a place of kind of reframing where we are in our life. So of our hopes, our dreams, and how we can live into those. My friends, may it be so for each of you, and also very much for me. Amen. Thank you. Friends, this is a time in our worship where we come to God and we lift up our prayers, prayers for our life and prayers for our world. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church throughout the world, for pastors and teachers, for deacons and deaconesses, and for musicians and servers that all proclaim the good news of God's reconciling love, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For skies and seas, the birds and fish, for favorable weather, clean water, for the well-being of creation, that God raise up advocates and scientists to guide our care for all the earth, let us pray. Have mercy on us, O God. For those who provide leadership in our cities and around the world, for nonprofit and non-governmental organizations, for planning commissions and homeless advocates, that God inspire all people in the just use of wealth, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For those who are sick, distressed, or grieving, for the outcasts and all who await relief, that in the midst of suffering, God's peace and mercy surround them, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For our congregation and community, for families big and small, for the organizations that meet here during the week, that God's steadfast love serve as a model for all relationships, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. In thanksgiving, for our ancestors in the faith whose lives serve as an example of gospel living, that they point us to salvation through Christ, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers for your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, our Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. Friends, let's turn to one another and pass the peace of Christ and say, God loves you and there's nothing you can do about it. Friends, this is a time in our worship where we gather for communion. We have blessed elements here. If you'd like them delivered, we can bring those to you, or you can come by the church office and we can give those to you. You can get some wine or some juice, some bread or some cracker, and we can gather for communion. If this is not your tradition, we ask that you remain with us in solidarity, knowing that we are united in our diversity and not our conformity. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, O God, for making your love evident from the beginning of time when you spoke the word that replaced the darkness of chaos with life-giving light. Through your love for the world, the word became flesh and lived among us full of grace and truth. The angels caroled glory to you in the highest heavens and peace to all people on earth. We join with them and all people to praise your holy name. Holy God, as the wise men and their treasures were overwhelmed with joy in finding Jesus, so we are overwhelmed by the depths of his love for us. Send the power of your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of bread and wine, O God, that we may experience the presence of the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ. Breathe your Spirit in us, that we may be one body with him, living out his ministry in this world today and every day. Friends, this is the most generous invitation that we can make in our tradition, and all are welcome to this table. If you've been baptized in Christ, you're welcome to this table. If you're seeking to know Christ, you are welcome to this table. All can come here, no matter where you're born, how much money you make, or who you love. When Jesus was with the disciples at the table, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it. And said, "This is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he poured the cup and said, "This is a new covenant that's sealed in my blood, that's shed for the forgiveness of sins. And every time you drink from this cup and you eat from this loaf, you'll proclaim the living Lord." My friends, these are the gifts of God, and all of you are the people of God. Gracious God, we lift up prayers of thanksgiving for this gift of wine and bread that restore, renew us, who are present with us in this meal, make us new in you to be the lights of Christ you call us to be. Amen. And now let us pray the perfect prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, as we go out into today, into this life, let's go with God's grace and know that we have little time to gladden the hearts of those who travel with us. Oh, be swift to love and make haste to be kind. Let's all go in peace. Amen. And as we go out, we have a prayer that we would like to read to you. We are recording on Wednesday, and at this time, there has been a new president of the United States. And we wanted to share the prayer from the inauguration, which I think speaks to a great depth to what we can be and what we strive to be. And this is the prayer from Reverend O'Donovan, the invocation. Gracious and merciful God, at this sacred time, we come before you in need. Indeed, on our knees, we come still more with hope, and our eyes raised anew to the vision of a more perfect union in our land, a union of all citizens to promote the general welfare and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our prosperity. We are people of many races and creeds and colors, national backgrounds, cultures, and styles, now far more numerous in our land, much vaster than when Archbishop John Carroll wrote his prayer for the inauguration of George Washington 232 years ago. Archbishop Carroll prayed that you, O Creator of all, would assist with your spirit of holy counsel and fortitude the President of these United States, that this administration might be conducted in righteousness and be eminently useful to your people. Today we confess our past failures to live according to our vision of equality, inclusion, and freedom for all. Yet we resolutely commit still more now to renewing the vision, caring for one another in word and deed, especially the least fortunate among us, and so becoming a light for the world. There's a power in each and every one of us that lives by turning to every other one of us, a thrust of the spirit to cherish and care and stand by others, and above all those most in need. It's called love, and its path is to give ever more of itself. Today it's called American patriotism, born not of power and privilege, but of care for the common good, with malice toward none, and with charity for all. For our new president, we beg of you the wisdom of Solomon, sought when he knelt before you and prayed for an understanding heart, that I can govern your people and know the difference between right and wrong. We trust in the counsel of the letter of James. If any of you likes wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. And Pope Francis has reminded us now how important it is to dream together. By ourselves, he wrote, we risk seeing mirages, things that are not there. Dreams, on the other hand, are built together. Be with us, Holy Master of Love, as we dream together. Help us under our new president to reconcile the people of our land, restore our dream, and invest it with peace and justice and the joy that is the overflow of love, the glory of your name, forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace and be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.